maybe a little one. Today's show is brought to you by the very concept of not giving a fuck. If at any point you feel you're in danger of giving even a solitary fuck, don't give none, for you will receive none. And I'm going nowhere with this. Over to Tom!
And that's my point of view, and welcome to the Pot Topic Podcast. I'm your host, Tom, and with me, I have other hosts. We have Heather Puddin.
Hey, y'all.
Who I had to throw to first because I could see she was trying to take a sip of beer. And Taryn.
Yo, what's going on? Hi, Paul.
Not much. I just heard a scream from my girlfriend next door who's playing DDR, so I'm a little bit worried.
Should play. Well, have you got a DDR mat?
I've got two DDR mats, mate.
Ooh.
Locked down in a pub with a huge projector. Come on.
Nice.
Anyway, on this podcast, we have several pots. I don't know how many. And some are filled with topics from our community. Some are filled with topics from our hosts. We pull them out at random. We bullshit for about 2 hours whilst drinking. What you got?
Today, I am drinking what can only really be described as Aldi Desperados. They're called El Bandido, and they taste always exactly the same. And no doubt, they were like a fraction of the cost.
Aldi Desperados, aren't they just extra desperate-os? No?
No. I mean, no. Yes and. Yes. And.
Yeah. I'm drinking vodka and cherry Pepsi Max, which is my go-to.
Dude, what is... Wrong. Everything is just wrong with that statement.
Not at all.
Everything is wrong with that statement. I hate you. I hate you.
What are you against me and the Russians? Racist.
No, it's the cherry cola.
Cherry Pepsi Max.
It's fucking cola.
I'm drinking squash. Oh yeah.
She is sensible.
I'll probably have a cider later, but at the moment, squash.
So what have we all been up to?
Lockdown. So on your recommendation, I've started playing Opus Magnum, which Hell is yeah. a nice little machine building puzzle game. And fuck. Oh, I really like it, Tom. I really
just,
like
oh, sorry,
it.
Sorry, burpees. Just wait until you get to like what chapter you're in.
I'm coming to the end of the second chapter, I think. Or have we started to make weapons now?
Yeah, it's when you get to like I think it might be the fourth or the fifth when it starts getting progressively harder and you know you can do it. And you know you can do it really quickly or really simply with a small like foot plate or whatever. And yeah. You spend 2 hours doing nothing, like not producing anything, just trying to refine every single movement. It's like the point where I realized that rotation of an arm is quicker than arm moving.
Is it?
Yeah. Wait until you get into that. So instead of doing a linear, conveyor belt almost of how you're making products, just try rotating. Just make it a circular pattern and then ship it off to somewhere. And then make another circular pattern and ship that off to somewhere.
I've tried that. I just don't have the fucking spatial awareness for it. There's a part of my... I'm working on that part of my brain. But we'll get there. There's nothing like when you solve it and then you kind of see the... where you fall in... the amount of space you've taken up. The amount of cycles. Like, how quickly you do it. And the amount it's cost. And, like, when you see, like, you're falling... like by the wayside somehow. It's so much fun just to go right back to it and go, right, I can do this better. I will do this better.
Yeah, I've spent 3 hours on this puzzle refining it, and now I'm going to refine it a different way in the next 2 hours.
So there's been that.
Did we do the flower bed before? I don't know when I last.
Oh yeah, dug a flower bed. We've dug a flower bed. We have a flower bed now. That's a thing that we have. That's
good.
I've never done it before. I even did a bit of turfing to make space for the flower bed. And now it's got flowers in it. And do you know what like flower beds mean?
Flowers?
No, it means cat shit. Like the second you start exposing earth, man, those cats, they just come all over. Just like, yeah.
Dug some up.
They come on it too.
Of course they do, mate. They're cats. They don't give a shit.
Last Friday, I finished a project that I started on week one of lockdown, which was making a little like basket out of plastic bags. So you cut the plastic bag, like the top and bottom of the plastic bag, and then you cut it into like a continuous strip and then plait it together. And then once you've plaited it all together, you then put the plaits around in a circle to make the base and then bring it all the way up the sides. And I made a basket for our bin because we normally just have a bin bag in the cupboard because I couldn't find a bin that was a good enough size to fit in the cupboard. So I've custom made my own one and used up all of the plastic bags that everyone keeps leaving at our house every time they come with alcohol. So we've got rid of the collection of bin bags and now made a little basket, and it looks quite cool. It's changed my life in putting shit in the bin, which is just ridiculous. It's really nice having an actual bin rather than just like a bin bag on the floor in your cupboard.
Life will never be the same again.
Yep. And then one thing that is throwing us up is I've started painting the little coffee table that we have next to the sofa, which now means that we don't have the coffee table to put shit on, which is gonna fuck us up for a while till I finish painting that. But I hand-drawn a mandala picture, and I'm going to do some mandala picture and painty thingy all on it. That's my next project.
Loads of home improvement stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Heather's remaining really quite crafty. There's always something else like that she's getting on with. Me, I've watched some shit.
Yes.
This is what I've done. I finished Devs. That's very good. I watched Noughts and Crosses. That's very good.
Watercarbon.
Oh yeah, that was weeks ago. All carbon. Yeah, season two was a bit. Yeah. But no, I mean that's pretty much my life. Like, and obviously like playing more Space Kings, which was actually quite cool the other day because it's obviously your gaming group, but the two of the lads got their girlfriends involved and they've never done role playing before. I just kind of watching them go from very quiet, not really understanding what's going on, to like towards the end of the session just spinning up new ideas and going, okay, I'm gonna do this, can I do this, I'm gonna try this, like, yes, it's so cool.
Yeah both ladies were extremely adept at using, because they both have psychic powers, both going, right, well, these fucking boys are gonna go rushing in like nuts, and we're actually gonna like psychically see if we can see enemies before running into the fray.
Yeah,
no, we felt stupid.
It was cool. Yeah, no, it's interesting. Like different play styles as well. The one was getting really good at figuring out, okay, can my character do this particular action? Like thinking about how to use her skills. And the other was thinking about the different ways they could interact with the world. And that was really cool. I really enjoyed that.
And being a good games master, you just went, yes, and every time. So
good games master. Right. Oh, cheers, Tom. Thanks, Max. Well, no,
you're very good at that.
I must say I'm very much enjoying seeing you put in. I think other than my I haven't seen your face in a very long time. But like my birthday, I guess, was the last time we
wait until you see this. Yeah.
The Donga stream.
It's nice seeing your face while doing the podcast, though.
this makes a hell of a difference, it's got to be said.
Yeah, the problem we're having, you won't hear it in the actual recording endurers at home. But the problem we're having is every time I talk, I can't hear anything, because the only way we've got this setup working is basically blasting all audio through Discord and hoping the echo cancellation software takes out me, which it does. Yeah. And then I can't hear anyone.
Yeah. So like, when anyone coming in over Discord is talking, they can't hear us on this end. Although you can hear each other, can't you?
Yeah, that's fine.
You just can't hear us. So, of course, that was the other thing. So you were trying to, it was really weird.
We spent about an hour today trying to work out that one minor problem. And every time we fuck everything up, we undo what we fucked up and we're back to square one and we go, oh, but let's try it this way. Fuck everything up. Get it back to square one.
It's got to be said, like, while it was frustrating, I did have an awful lot of fun just kind of sitting there trying to figure out how does sound tech work?
It doesn't. It doesn't follow any laws of physics. It doesn't follow any kind of logic. It just doesn't work.
Just witchcraft is all it is.
It was entertaining.
If any endurers out there want to give us a hand, we're using voice meter potato and we're using a Behringer mixing desk, a USB one track out. But
I do like the amount of work. We finally got it to a point where we were in exactly the same situation where we are now. And that took about 45 minutes. And then at the end of it, I was just like, fuck it. I've lost track of everything.
Uninstall
everything. Let's just go back to basics.
But yeah, that's been the frustrating end of my nerd week. I have had such a fucking nerdy week this week.
You have. Tell us about your week, sir.
So just an example, I'm going to pick 2 days out of this week to talk about. Mm-hmm. First was the mega nerd day. Woke up, played Warhammer with Danny, trying a new army each. So I tried Tau army.
Oh, Warhammer playing... on...
Sorry?
Tabletop Simulator.
On Tabletop Simulator, exactly.
Shut up!
Yeah, Danny Shut told up. Me, and then told me that he can play with you and that he didn't need to buy any new Warhammer, so you weren't going to dump me. No. And I didn't tell you because I didn't want you to know.
This is the second time we've done it.
Yeah.
So originally he played Orcs and I played Chaos Marines and had a lot of fun. I just about took him in that game. And then this game I was playing Tau and he was playing Necrons. And you know how much I hate playing Necrons, because you always fucking have a Necron army.
Yeah,
I hate fucking... There's nothing worse than space Terminators that die and resurrect themselves continuously.
Yeah, baby.
How fun is it in a war game to have a unit type, their basic unit type, called Immortals? What the fuck? But yeah. Got through that. That was fun. He took me completely in that next game. I kept fucking up and forgetting rules. And he gave me as many boons as he retakes and stuff as he could possibly give me without breaking the game. But I fucked it up constantly.
Yeah. I mean, you were, it's an uphill battle. I always struggled against Tau armies when I was running Necrons. Their ranged capabilities is just...
And I specifically built an army not to win, but to learn every single rule. So every unit had different special rules.
Ah, okay.
And cool. You know me, I can't do that. I can't keep track of 600 different rules.
Oh, shit, dude.
But it's fun. I learned.
Oh, no.
Yeah, there was a reason I wasn't telling Tad.
But that's how I started the day. So then my 3D printer got delivered.
Perfect.
So then set that fucker up. That was fun. That works, by the way. Printed. First print, perfect.
Amazing.
Did you print off a penis bong?
No, it was just the test print, but I do have several penis bongs that I can print out now. Not for myself, of course.
Of course.
I only ever smoked tobacco, but no, I don't even do that. And then in the evening, we played Space Kings. It was a couple sessions ago. And then decided to get completely tanked up. And with my mate Tom, where I live in the pub, we just played 3-card poker till about 5 o'clock in the morning.
3-card poker?
Yeah, so it's like normal poker, but instead of constantly dealing out cards, you deal 3 cards to you, your opponents, and then three cards in the middle of the table, one of them face up. You have three lives. Usually they're £5 notes or £10 notes.
Okay.
I learned this one in sixth form, so we used to play with pound coins.
Of course.
And whoever has the lowest hand chucks a quid in, and you lose lives that way. And whoever ends with lives remaining and everyone else dead, they take the money.
Awesome.
Okay. So yeah, that's what we were doing. The next day, woke up and played with Danny TikTok A Tale for Two, which is this really fucking cool puzzle game where you and your friend only ever see half the puzzle because you're playing on totally different devices.
Oh, and
they have no internet connectivity and stuff. It's literally the puzzle solving allows you to progress in steps, like one person, then the other person. Then
awesome.
It highly, highly recommend. And then got out of that phone call and was just like, you know what I should do? Order all the Tingleverse RPG books.
Oh man.
I've got so much reading, man. There's so much.
They're
like all like
wait.
An inch thick.
Wow.
Yeah,
they're
yeah.
Ridiculous.
Yeah. I mean, one of them is like a monster manual essentially though, isn't it? So it's just like.
And a couple of them are just campaign settings, but.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
Oh, dude, I cannot wait. I cannot wait to play that.
It's the fact that Chuck Tingle's written it and gone, look, all you need to play this game is a group of people who want to believe that love is real. That was like the opening of the handbook. It's just like, that's quite nice.
Awesome. Oh man.
Right. But yeah, that's basically in my week.
I'll be interested to see like what the fucking mechanics are in that game.
Especially when you bring in like anthropomorphized bikes.
Of course.
But yeah. So, should we get on with the show?
Yeah, fuck it. Why the hell not? Let's do a show. I will start off by getting one from El Hottie de la Potty. One from the hosts.
I'm going to quickly say our community pot is empty at the moment. So please, all your endurers out there, go out and submit one. Go to pottopicpodcast.com, click on submit a topic by clicking the submit topic button at the top of the screen, fill in the submit a topic form, make sure you have selected submit a topic in the second box down on the drop down box, then type in your submit a topic into the submit a topic box, and then click submit a topic at the bottom, and it should submit the topic, hopefully. Maybe.
Need to sample that and turn it into a track. All right. Okay, cool. Here we go. If COVID-19 was a person, who would they be?
That's from Taz.
That's from me. This is, fuck, what's his name? What's the English boy that works for Alex Jones?
The anti-vax dude.
Yeah,
Doctor.
Yeah. Not him. He's like, he's a young lad, who does his own, like, right-wing punditry on his own, YouTube channel, but he's kind of a senior editor for Alex Jones as well.
I'm not sure.
English. Oh no, that's the wrong Alex Jones. That's the nice Alex Jones, the lovely Welshie. But yeah, I'm thinking someone like that. I don't think it's quite awful enough to be like quite up to the level of Katie Hopkins, but kind of close.
See, I think it's probably COVID-19 is a parent that is so fucked off with their child, they're grounded, but still is not rational and killing a lot of people. No? We've all been there. Go to your room, stay there. You're not allowed out. It's for your own good. You'll learn. And also, I'm going to kill some fuckers to get around this anger.
I tell you who COVID-19 would be if it was a person. Even though this isn't a person, but they would essentially be the walking embodiment of Jaden Smith's Twitter feed.
I can solve all life's problems because I know Exactly.
No.
I understand where everyone's coming from.
I has the wisdoms, yes?
Check out my Gucci handbag.
Any ideas, baby? Who, if COVID-19 was a person, who would they be?
I was trying to think of a Disney person that they might be to make it easier to decide on something, but I could only really think of the baddie from Hunchback of Notre Dame, but I can't remember what his name is anyway.
It'd be a bit Gaston, I reckon. Just kind of throwing his weight around, but being a bit of a twat. Like, not like, we're not, this isn't like full blown global murder death plague of the likes of, like the bubonic plague or Spanish flu. I mean, it's serious, but it's not hitting those levels. So I think Gaston is like the level of villainy it would be if it was a Disney villain. Like, we're not talking Scar, and we're definitely not talking Ursula.
He definitely also has a following. So those those protesters that are protesting for the virus.
The dude from Gaston fan. Of Notre Dame. Because he's like bad and doesn't really care if some people die along the way. And
yeah, but you don't remember his name, so he's clearly not that important.
Yeah,
but... that's a good idea, though. Well, I like where you're going.
Cough like COVID and stuff. I am far too hungover to try and fucking ad lib a song. I don't, what are you doing, Taz? Fucking
someone's already done that song as well in COVID.
Oh, have they?
Yeah. Someone's already done it. Oh. It already sounds good.
I've got it. Yeah. You know, in Futurama, they have the bad robot Santa. Everyone has to lock themselves inside.
Oh, yeah.
For fear of death, because they're bad little boys and girls.
Yeah.
There we go. Not an actual person again, but...
Do you know what? COVID-19 is basically if M. Night Shyamalan tried to write a plague.
And the twist is, it's cured by vitamin C.
All right, cool.
The cure is not being a dickhead. You'll never
stop
find it.
Stop licking people. all right. Cool. Well, fuck it. Should we have one from the... Have we got any from the... We got
no. I just said we've got an empty pot.
Oh, man. Okay. I think we're going to run out. I think if we've got no endurance topics...
If we run out, we'll make up topics. Come on.
Well, we just chat, shoot the shit. Why not? All right, baby.
All you cunts are sitting around. Sorry, not cunts. Endurers are sitting around at home, not doing anything. Send us some topics.
Get wild with it.
Oh, this question's really hard.
Go on.
It's from Tom, and it says, great. What movie monster would you have as a pet? And I want all of the cute things as a pet. But Frozen 2, that little fire, what was it? A little fire... chameleon-y kind of thing was really...
Oh, the salamander.
Fire salamander. That was really, really adorable. But then also the little blob thing from Treasure Planet, and then a little morph. He might morph.
These aren't movie monsters.
They are movie monsters. They're monsters in movies.
They're movie creatures. I think, like, if we're going to be... If we're going to go with monsters, we've got to choose like an actual monster.
Okay, Kraken.
Yeah. Okay.
It's just so she can drink.
Is that from the Odyssey, the Kraken originally?
No, it's fucking Perseus's one, Clash of the Titans.
Clash of the Titans, thank you. Yeah, that's it. I couldn't remember if it was Jason the Argonauts. The Odyssey.
It's some of that old classical shit.
It's all that shit that's the same, you know, hero's journey and all that.
Does Chewbacca cast as a movie monster? I have him.
He's basically just a dude in a gimp suit that's got a bit furry.
Okay, technically not movie, but definitely monster. You know that episode of X-Files where the dude is like... completely like rubbery, can squeeze into anything and has to eat
toads.
Yes, him. Yeah. That I'd have that as a pet.
It's like the second episode of X-Files, and it's like the best. Yeah. Everyone always, when they think of X-Files, they go straight to Tombs every time.
For me,
it's either that one or the one where there are like creatures living in the woods who are actually like the trees and stuff.
So for me, like the two other episodes for me would be the Cats in the Museum one or the one where they go to the circus and there's like a murder that happens there. And
And it's all the geeks and the freaks.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Big pardon. Punkcast. Trying to think. I feel like I've definitely seen, like, I've watched something that should have been horrifying, but I've kind of just gone, aw.
Oh, shit. You know what? Another thing that I've done on my Geek Week, and I'm getting to why this is my pet, is I've subscribed to Shudder. The Netflix for horror. It's not as good as I was hoping, but I'm going to use it for a couple months at least and just like mine it dry because I've been watching a fuck ton of schlocky, terrible B movies and I fucking adore them.
Sounds so good.
But I highly, highly recommend Hook by Crook, fucking steal it, pirate the cunt. Please watch Boar. It's an Australian horror film that is
about
basically
digging?
It's a giant boar, like a wild boar that's terrorizing. Like, I'm talking the things the size of a house. It's ridiculous.
Oh, man, we need to get this to Cody Johnston.
Yeah, but it's the fact that this boar, like, the writing in it is so honest to God what an Australian would say in these faced with these things. It's just like, you're going to leave me on your own, you shit cunt. Like that kind of thing. It's like perfect compass. It's not put on. It's proper Australian in conversation with another Australian. And it doesn't come off as fake whatsoever. It's so honest. It's beautiful.
Oh, okay, cool. Boar.
So I'm going to have the boar as my pet because he actually looked like a bit of fun.
Is it
like he used to play, he'd play fetch and shit.
Is it like a proper big fucking boar?
It's the size of a house.
Please tell me it like runs across something, like say somebody's driving along and he just kind of quickly just runs across the road. Please tell me that somebody at some point goes, Struth.
I didn't hear a Struth. There were plenty of like fucking elves and like core blimeys and yeah.
Core blimeys?
Very good. Not bleeding owl and all that.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Those words that we share with the Australians.
Gotcha. That does sound good.
How about the classic Hammer horror movies monsters? Which one would you like? I think probably the creature from Black Lagoon would be quite easy. Just set him up like a nice little vivarium.
Yeah,
it'd be all right.
Mm-hmm.
Tom,
just give him a bimbo every now and again.
Tom,
yeah,
I might be about to rock your world.
Go on.
I have never watched a single Hammer horror. Not, not even. Sorry. All right, I was wondering what that was.
I pressed it; and it didn't respond.
Like, considering how much I love horror, I've never watched a single Hammer. And
so, could you cleanly pee in my mouth, please?
Yeah, no, that's. I mean, it's not a good thing, but you are excused because Hammer horror is schlocky as fuck. It just is.
I mean, I love schlock though. Like,
I could probably watch Hammer horror.
But I think you might have been spoiled by those things that have preceded it. Oh, no, sorry, come after it.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That have built on that kind of schlocky feel and made it a theme rather than just being a consequence of when it was filmed.
Sure.
Frankenstein would be fun.
Frankenweenie, the little dog.
Frankenweenie, yeah, that's definitely a monster.
Yeah, I get that then.
I saw that in the cinema.
Would Frankenstein be fun? Oh, hello, who's this popping in?
That's Dom.
Oh, it's Dom.
That's Dom.
Hello.
Hi.
Can I drag that across? No.
Yeah, let's turn him up.
Yo, what's going on, Dom?
I've just come back from my allotment.
Nice. How are the bees?
Oh, how are the bees?
That's tomorrow.
Oh.
But
oh, okay.
My friend said that he had one of his hives swarm today.
Cool.
When he wasn't there.
Oh, no.
Well, that's a bad thing.
Oh.
Yeah, you don't want them to swarm.
Yeah. They fuck off.
Yeah,
he's lost about 30,000 bees. Somewhere.
But, oh, okay. But, hang on. Oh, so you're supposed to catch them and then just put them in a new hive, are you?
Mm-hmm.
I see.
Or you artificially swarm them by, like, you take the queen and some of the bees and you move them and then you...
Not the bees.
Or you leave them there, then you move the hive.
Yeah.
And it confuses them to think that they've swarmed themselves.
Would you say you have to work it, queen?
Yas Queen. So Dom, we were just discussing which movie monster would you like as a pet?
Ooh.
Well, you think we haven't had any kaiju. It'd be a bit hard to take him for a walk, but
yeah, but fuck me. Mothra would be
great.
Oh, son.
Yeah.
That's a fucking idea.
I get a fucking Mothra to walk, and I get a fucking huge suit thing.
I like the idea that you'd be in a Jaeger, and you'd be walking your kaiju, but like, I just like the idea that you wouldn't have like a proper leash or harness or anything for it. You'd have like a bit of string tied around its neck. So I'm just like imagining like Mothra, just huge and flapping, need a bit of string.
Good fucking shout. Right, what other movie monster franchises are there? Ghostbusters? Let's think of that. Slimer would be pretty cool.
Slimer would be a good one. Yeah, for sure.
Maybe one of those hellhounds at the end of the first one. Oh no, second one, isn't it?
First one.
You're right, first one.
Three-headed dog?
Plus, one of them Sigourney Weaver. Is it Sigourney Weaver? Yeah.
Is she a monster? I mean, she is a monster, but I don't think she really counts.
Technically,
there is
no
she is.
Okay, so we could rule out Alien because my God, what a nightmare. Predator. I could. But then it might be a little too sensitive to have.
If you manage to tame one, yeah.
I think when they're that intelligent, Tom, it's not so much a matter of taming as it is befriending.
Oh, you've seen AVP, haven't you?
You have to Danny Glover it up.
God. Oh no, he was like the Predator's worst enemy. He was in two of the films.
He wasn't in the first one. He was in Predator 2, wasn't he? And then did he?
Yeah,
come
but.
Back?
He was in the first one. He was the one who was like, you son of a bitch. Handshake.
Was that Danny Glover? No, that wasn't Danny Glover.
No, it wasn't. I'm getting confused.
Surprise fact, Danny Glover, Donald Glover, not actually related.
Despite the fact they have the same surname and black. Who would thunk it?
I'm sorry.
Like I'm not related to Meg Ryan.
I'm definitely stealing that bit. It's a bit I'm stealing from Britannic. Shame me. This doesn't bode well for the rest of the show. I am drawing a blank on everything, and I suspect it's because of the hangover.
I've got over the hangover, and I'm now getting drunk. So good luck, everyone.
What about
these nuts? Got him!
What about a miniature version of the things from Tremors? Might make a cute pet.
Which ones do you mean? Oh, sorry. Didn't mean to do that. Do you mean Graboids, Shriekers, or what, the flying ones?
Not the flying ones.
I'd go for a... were they called Shriekers? The little walkie bastards?
Yeah. The ones with no eyes. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
The walking ones. They're Shriekers. Don't question me.
Fair enough. No. Absolutely fair enough.
Soot gremlins.
But technically...
Game changer.
Before we go on to the much better one, just go back to Tremors quickly.
Yeah.
Technically, Bert Gummer and the rest of the residents of Paradiso do have a pet graboid. It's El Blanco, the sterile graboid that they look after in the TV series.
Oh, I haven't seen the TV series.
The reason why no one's allowed to roll in and wipe out the village and make it an industrial place is because it's an endangered species natural reserve.
Ah, nature reserve. Okay, cool.
Yeah, anyway, Gremlins way the best
answer. Yeah, that is probably the best answer. Well done, Tom. And I...
No, it wasn't. I was saying Soot Gremlins from Spirited Away.
No.
Oh, yes. But that's not technically a moving monster. That's a creature. That's a creature. Well, they're no threat.
Depends if you get a lot of them.
Would you rather fight a 100 horse-sized soot monster or 100 soot monsters?
Yeah. Okay. So that's an interesting thing you pose there, Dom. Like if they become a monster just through sheer numbers and causing a problem, because by that metric we could also include tribbles.
Yeah.
Yeah,
tribbles is the worst one. You don't want one of those as a pet.
I would, though.
No, but the whole problem is they multiply asexually.
Oh, was it? Oh, yeah, no, that's right. I do you know what? I was getting confused with gremlins. I thought they kept feeding them, and that's how they reproduced.
No, their thing was that, okay, if you get really into the canon, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, the one person listening, that they asexually reproduce but genetically mutate with every generation, hence the different colors of
fur. See, I mean, that's a good workaround for the fact that the property department obviously didn't have enough furry felt in one color.
Yeah, I mean, there's only so many Shatner wigs you can pull out of the wardrobe department, you know.
last answer, Karate Kid from The Karate Kid.
Is he a monster?
Oh, of course he's a monster.
Thanks, Sam.
And he's one that you'd want as a pet.
Ah, no, that's right. Well, only to murder it.
Actual last answer, the Vampire Night Bus.
Actual answer, the Magic School Bus.
The bus from Totoro.
Cat bus.
He's
not a monster. He's not a monster.
He's not a monster. He's too cute. Okay, cool. Well, let's fucking leave that one there.
Where do you draw the line between cute creature and monster, though?
There is no line.
There is a line. There's quite the threat level.
I think it needs to be, isn't it?
On Boris's threat level of Nando's, it needs to at least be a 4.
Cat bus sees red and just drives through a group of school children. Cute, wise school children.
I like that. Yeah, so like your average like apex predator, say like a crocodile, your average crocodile would be like a 3. But the second if you get like a really, really smart one, one that gets like the taste for human meats and gets really good at getting it, that's where it becomes a 4. And that's how you, that's how it graduates from creature to monster. I like this, Tom.
So I think probably the taste of human meat, we're talking about the Vampire Night Bus again, aren't we?
That did make me think of the movie, is it Deep Blue, where the sharks get like super, super intelligent.
Yeah.
Deep Blue Sea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Deep Blue Sea, yeah.
The best Samuel L. Jackson death.
Yeah. he's wearing glasses and everything. It's brilliant.
The first film ever released to DVD.
We're going
to
survive and... Oh, Billy.
Really?
You knew it was coming, though. It was so well telegraphed. That's one of those deaths in a movie that's telegraphed and executed so well. Just, yeah.
I don't remember it. Oh, no. It's the one good bit in that movie.
It's the only good bit in that movie.
We used to watch it so much when I was like 14.
Why?
I don't know. It was just one of the ones that we used to watch all the time. That, Leon, and Mean Girls, we'd watch all the time, me and my friends.
Ah. I was watching Road Trip.
That's a monster.
Yeah, go on.
But what about the bit from Tron?
the bit.
Yeah. I mean, technically, you could consider that as a threat, so... Oh, shit, the thing.
I thought about the thing, and I honestly want no fucking part of that whatsoever.
No, because then I could also have a stuntman called Dick Warlord. Now, that's a fucking callback.
That's such a... Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, cool. Let's leave that one there. Tom, would you like to propose a topic?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We've got loads in there.
Yeah, but, I mean, they can't draw from that.
How about we do one more and I think of a topic while we're doing it?
Okay.
You put me on the spot.
Sure thing. Unless, Dom, you've got anything ready to go.
Nope.
All right, cool. Then I shall draw one I'm just going to call it the pot. There's no other pots. It's just the pot.
It's the host hot pot.
Let's see. This is from Hev. What will be the next worldwide incident? What will be the next worldwide incident after COVID-19? I think we're probably overdue an asteroid at this point, aren't we?
The next American Civil War.
Yeah. Well, I said that's not. Is it a worldwide event? I mean, I suppose it will have a knock on effect.
It'll have ramifications.
The temperature over in America is just. It's just heating up and heating up.
Yeah, but it's also boiling. Just look at today where we had all the fucking protests in London, pro-virus protests. Like, it happens in America and then it all fucking trickles down. This is Reaganomics. Reaganomics in action. It's the idiocy of the United States just pouring out to the rest of the world.
Yeah, we were sort of talking about this today, Heather and I, and there's just a growing sense of distrust in authority, but more so like expert authority, like, you know, authoritarians are always going to be authoritarian, but
people have confused intellectuals or an intellectual argument with that of oppression and authority. The idea that the people in power are dumb, we know that. However, experts and scientists and people that know what the fuck they're talking about have been lumped into that camp. Yes. And so we've ended up in the position we were in now.
Yeah, it's
which leads me to believe that the next uprising will be an anti-fascist and a pro-intellectualism fight against fucking morons.
That would be interesting. But if you're gonna,
and I have a feeling we'll be in the minority, motherfucker. We are so in the minority.
The thing is, Tom, if there was ever like a genuine war against stupid people, how is that not just eugenics by another name?
I never said I was against eugenics.
Oh, that's a shame.
Look, I still have a book on my bookshelf that I need to read that Hal and Beth gave me for Christmas one year. And it's like genes, brains and cells, eugenics arguments. And it's just like, what the fuck are they giving me for Christmas? I have no idea what this thing is.
Eugenics arguments are making a weird sort of comeback of late. We're starting to hear. Did you? There was a. Oh no, you've read. Was it Nations? No, not Nations. Natives, haven't you? By Akala.
To be fair, I've not quite finished it, but the vast majority of the book, yeah.
Yeah, there's that whole bit. I completely missed, but the London Olympics. There was a bit where they the two hosts. So there was a video that, from the sounds of it, basically made the argument that black people are fast because white people enslaved, and that then made them fast because they had to run. And then, like, the two presenters, like, just like plain faced, straight faced, turned to like three really quite prolific black athletes and said, "What are your thoughts on this?" It's like, how? How have we gotten here? This is ridiculous.
Yeah. And also raised in that same chapter is the argument that people of African origin genetically are physically superior in sprinting events as an excuse as to why white people aren't winning gold medals anymore.
Yeah, right?
It's just like...
I'm sure it has absolutely nothing to do...
You have an upper hand we never had. However, we are in control of the planet, so fuck you.
Yeah, I'm sure it has absolutely nothing to do with the funding and prestige that goes into those events in those cultures. Yeah, sure, it's got absolutely nothing to do with that. No, it must be the genes. Fucking
it's the genes. Yeah, you have an upper hand in one particular area, whereas we have everything else, so...
the American Civil War was a good shout. The one I've seen that there's been like an escalation of sorts where did you see the article or the news that, some gun toting white folk, picketed Michigan Capitol House? Stop a lawmaker from getting in, doing their job and making laws. Like, it's been stepped up recently because that lawmaker got escorted to Capitol House by a group of armed black guys. So you've got
the Black Panthers are back.
I mean, you can only hope, man. You can only hope.
What? People that actually care about their community and do everything they can to help the community.
That would be nice.
Yeah, let's hope they're back.
Well, they were saying that, is it called the Archangels?
Yeah, the guys that went on the New York subway, yeah.
They're back.
I've not heard of the Archangels.
Is it Archangels or Guardian Angels? Guardian Angels.
Guardian Angels.
Yeah, they used to wear like red berets and used to go on the New York subway and walk around Central Park and that kind of thing just to make it safe for people so they weren't mugged or raped or...
Oh, cool.
Basically, yeah.
It was ex-bikers, ex-squaddies, ex...
They were always a bit rough for background, yeah. They were willing to crack some skulls, but...
I say cool, but really, it's not cool at all, is it?
The fact that has to exist.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's really quite distressing.
And again, that can be seen as authoritarianism. So, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. So, if not that... I don't know.
Next event after COVID, I hope, is a big bouncy castle.
Yeah.
It's not going to be, though, is it? Unless the asteroid I talked about was actually just like a giant bouncy castle that flies in from space. And that's how we find out about life on other planets.
Because the next American Revolution is nothing more than a fun house.
I don't know. There's a little bit of me that would hope there'd be some kind of workers' action across the globe after COVID kind of settles down a bit. Because obviously we've all seen another way of living and another way of working now. And it'd be nice to act in some way towards that, but I don't see that as very likely.
Well, it's the fact that we came through the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s, in fact, the building up the strength of the union, the strength of the people. Mm. 80s hit, it was all about money and capitalism, and it's just been a downward rocket since then. So we're just swinging back and forth, left and right wing, but... Yeah. As I said from the very beginning, this lockdown, I'm really worried about sick days, workers' rights, things like that. And
I mean, that's been for me ever since the Tories. Well, each time Tories have taken power over the course of Brexit, that's become like a bigger and bigger worry because you keep hearing things about the human rights being kind of scrapped. Because they're not being carried over from like European law or something, which is always a concern. Mm. But hey, no, it's cool. I mean, if we have to work more, that's fine. Work will set you free.
Work will set you free to let you ignore the fact that you are doing nothing but working like a proles that you are.
I mean, yeah, Well, work will set you free eventually from life. That's why it was over the gates of Auschwitz, wasn't it? Ah, that's a... That was a dark joke, Nazis.
Do you know what they had on the exit to Auschwitz?
It's time for the percolator. It's time for the percolator.
Anyway.
I don't know. Who fancies, like, what about a natural disaster? If not asteroids, what else could be coming, do you reckon?
A global warming, killing the planet.
So, yeah.
Happening now.
To be fair, I think that's the last step. The last step.
Ice Age before 2.0.
Ice Age. Okay, we'll slot that in just before the global warming. We'll have an Ice Age. Mm-hmm. And after, we'll bookend it. We'll bookend...
There's still a little bit of me that feels like we are past due coming up to the point where everything west of the San Andreas Fault slides into the sea.
Cool. Well, I think that's probably a short-term one. We'll probably sort that in first or second.
We have
murder hornets. Can we have some death hippos?
I mean, Tom, are not all hippos, in fact, death hippos?
Yes,
but they don't all listen to Danzig.
How about, like, turret hippos? Hippos that have just, like, gimbaled turrets on their back. So that Ballista hippos.
Repeating ballista hippos.
Tactical nuclear hippos.
I've now got the new nickname for my next hamster.
this one's called TNH. Oh, what does that stand for? Tactical nuclear hippos. okay, what about something fucking wild? Maybe the entire world decides to go like 90s, 20s America-style prohibition and all alcohol is banned. Nah, that's never going to happen.
No.
No, what about just entropy?
Just general...
Entropy.
Well, no, just
everyone loses just energy.
What's the point?
The great apathy of 2021.
The plague of ennui.
Ennui.
I don't think he's even going to wait for like COVID to die down. It's going to happen in the midst of this, I reckon, and it's going to be fucking swell.
Maybe the second spike that takes out all the people who have been going to protest.
I mean, it'd be nice to actually get out the first wave. I don't think we're going to get out the first wave. I think this is going to be a nice little logarithmic graph all the way up. You can't have a second wave if you don't leave the first wave. That's my mantra.
Modern problems require modern solutions.
Exactly. Using the old noodle.
My abiding and all-time greatest fear is that there might one day be a crow that has thumb mutations. Because if crows ever develop opposable thumbs, man, we're fucked.
Straight up done, son.
What if IKEA furniture becomes sentient?
Oh no, not Lazoog.
I'm bent on destroying the human race.
It's
already in your home.
To be fair, they're always bent. It's IKEA furniture.
But... yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking. It'd be like, It'd be like an onslaught from people who aren't particularly well abled. You know, every bit of furniture's got a limp, or it kind of.
I was so tempted to press special poetry slam werewolf right now on the soundboard, but I won't because it's really offensive.
Special poetry slam werewolf.
Google it. Anyway, carry on.
We don't own any IKEA furniture. We have a basket, and that's the only thing from IKEA that we have.
Yeah, man.
What's your food, Tom?
Oh, that's from M Sofas.
That's our sofa. It's from M Sofa.
Oh, the futon is from Dunelm.
Okay, fair enough.
we're higher class than no. We just went. We went to IKEA.
Got a mortgage and no IKEA furniture.
We went to IKEA and we bought the house and looked around, and both me and Taz were like, "I don't really like anything here. We'll buy a wicker basket to put the onions and potatoes in, but that's it."
That's pretty much it, isn't it? I feel like we bought something else.
No, that was the only meatballs. Thing we bought. Yeah, we had meatballs. We had vegetarian meatballs.
That's it. That's the next event. IKEA runs out of meatballs. The world goes into fiery revolt.
No, it's okay, because they've released a recipe, I think, IKEA did this lockdown, so people can make the...
Yeah, I saw
home.
That.
God three damn... Horses. God damn sweet. They're always one step
one
ahead of the game.
One cup of horse meat.
If you can't find horse, I suppose beef will have to do, but...
Giant wild boar.
I would really like to see some more boar action. I love it. I know some more news. The whole thing is like a absolutely a gag. But I don't know, this is their time to strike, man. There's less people on the streets. There's less people to like get in the way and hunt them down. Like, this is the time. This could be the boar's time.
Australia's not real. Like, they've got nothing to fear.
And the birds are fake.
Hey, what? I love my birds.
Sorry, Dom?
No, I was about to say, they're just like animatronics nowadays.
Absolutely. They're just extremely, complex drones, is what they are. Elaborate?
Yeah.
Oh my God, my brain can't do the word, thank good.
I love the fact we always record a podcast after drinking. Like, I'm still hungover.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's go for a midday.
Enjoy it.
Let's go for a weekday podcast next time. I think Saturdays are a bad idea.
It's lockdown. Every day's a Saturday.
not for me.
Or a Sunday.
There's still a differentiation between like weekdays and weekends for me.
Like, really? Is there?
Yeah.
Trousers.
Like, on a weekday.
I like the fact that Heather says that, and then Becky's also looking at you going, what the fuck are you talking about?
Like, if it's a weekday, come about 2 p.m, there is a chance I might be productive for about 4 hours.
No, there's a chance you might be sober for 4 hours.
I'm sorry, Heather. And back to our regular segment, Domestics with Heather and Taz. I beg your fucking pardon, baby. I'm sorry.
Every day.
Wait. You've got to have the theme tune first.
Oh, yeah, please do.
And it's the domestic half hour. Brought to you by Potomy Podcast and Chum. Chum is your food that you can eat too.
Are you saying I've not been productive at all? Because that's what it feels like you're saying, baby.
I'm saying that you have been productive sometimes, but it's not been a general Monday to Friday every week since lockdown that you've been...
See, this is, again, you never listen to the words I actually use. I said at 2 o'clock on weekdays,
so could you clearly pee in my mouth?
I might be productive for 4 hours or so.
Okay, yeah, there's a chance, a 1 in 10 chance, a 1 in 5.
Oh, bitch. Oh,
what did you just say?
Bitch, I'm stuck. I beg your fucking pardon.
Ding, 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 ding. Heather wins. Right.
What did I do? What did I do yesterday?
The guys just quoted RuPaul behind us. Look over there. What did you do yesterday?
Yeah, what did I do yesterday?
I mean, I painted a table yesterday. What did you do yesterday?
You drank. Taryn, you drank. You're hungover. You drank.
You played your game a bit, and then...
Oh, I mean,
you
I
played
did,
your
I
game
did,
most of the day, and I then
did,
I asked
I did,
you to do
I did the
emails.
Book report.
You did the book
and report. And I did cook a proper meal.
You did.
Yeah. And then what did I do Thursday? Stuff. I don't know. This feels like a boring game. Anyway, shall we... talking about book reports, shall we get on with it?
Well, that's a segue. Speaking of which, there's one in the story.
Chuck. Tingle. Chuck. Tingle. Chuck. Tingle. Chuck. I'm Fiona Bruce, and welcome to
the Chuck Tingle Book Club.
Oh, yeah.
Cool. So welcome to the Chuck Tingle Book Club. This week we were reading Space Raptor Butt Invasion. It was the free book that was given away in Vampire Night Bus that we visited a couple issues ago. And it's our first sci-fi offering, really, if you don't include time travel. Hard sci-fi.
This is hard sci-fi.
I could sum up this book. I've written notes this time. I've actually done a proper synopsis, but it's basically The Martian, but with butt-fucking dinosaurs.
Is it The Martian? Yeah.
A little bit. At least the beginning of The Martian. Probably yes. Doesn't have the same ending. Don't know. But anyway. Quick little synopsis. So, we open on Zorbus, an outpost on a rock of a planet, as Officer Pike is handing over a terraforming station to our protagonist, Lance.
Quick note on the name Pike, because it's not included in my essay, but I liked the names Lance and Pike. They're very good sci-fi names. Obviously, you got Lance from Lance Armstrong, like the first man on the moon, and Pike, Captain Pike, the original captain of the Enterprise. I thought they were good choices.
I also, they're big sticks with pointy bits on it.
They are both that, aren't they?
They're both practically the same weapon.
They're both,
if you think about it,
both phallic representations meant to, yeah.
Quite possibly.
Very good.
But yeah, Lance will be alone up here, budget cuts and everything, as you might imagine, and he'll be there for a whole year on his own. Humanity has less than 10 years left on Earth. No capitalized. A note, please, as well, that is not capitalized correctly, Earth, in this book.
No.
It annoyed the shit out of me. And we need to find a new home as humanity. As Pike departs, he caringly warns Lance that space can be weird and not to think too hard, keep it light, because people can start seeing things. Mm. On the walk back from the launch pad, Lance literally spots, as if fucking pointed out on purpose by Pike, spots another astronaut who drives off on a two-wheeled vehicle, basically a Segway, as the cover art will depict. Obviously, he's quite spooked by this.
Oh, I assumed it was a bike of some description. I haven't actually looked at the cover
for
this.
Yeah, wait until you look at the cover art. Okay, it's a space raptor on a fucking Segway. Sorry, spoilers. Yeah, so this is no hallucination, because hallucinations don't leave tracks. Lance checks with the computer, but no astronaut's been sent from Earth. So, passed out on the couch, awoken by loud knocking on the hatch door, Lance is thrown into a state of fear. Orion is the name of the other spaceman, as they introduce himself. And Orion is a velociraptor from Earth 2, spelled the number 2, not T-double-O.
Which is almost a shame.
Yeah. But it turns out, well, technically, his species is from our Earth. Because it turns out the dinosaur extinction event is nothing more than revisionist history. And they're actually left Earth 1 because it sucked a bit. Didn't really get into it. Earth 1 sucks. So they found a new one. Realizing Orion is also up here and missing home as a lone astronaut, much like himself, Lance offers maybe you'd want to hang out for a bit. And they do. They cohabitate for a while, in fact. Story as old as time. Man meets dinosaur. Man and dinosaur hang out. Man and dinosaur decide it's not gay if they're different species. Dinosaur doms the fuck out of man, and with his big red dino cock, no less.
Endurers, I wish you could have seen Tom's face as he just pronounced the word cock then. It was magnificent.
It was very forceful. Speaking of forceful... The set scene follows. Wanking blowjob, slipping past gag reflex, ongoing theme. Dino on man butt sex, testing the limits of aching tightness, again, ongoing theme. Hair pulling doggy style, blossoming prostate orgasm, stops too soon. Blissed out sexual trance, that is a quote. Orgasm, forceful pumping, quote. You've been a bad astronaut, so you're gonna take my Jurassic load up your asshole and you're gonna like it. Fervorous begging ensues. The word fervor is used in the book. Please fill my... Oh, sorry. Please fill me with your nasty dino load. Twitching butt eruption happens. Now Lance isn't so worried of being alone for the next year. And that is the book.
Tom, if we stop doing this as a thing, or even as like a separate thing, can I just suggest like a new segment for the podcast is we pick a porn scene for you to summarize just like that.
It does tend to be my thing. It's the fact that I was writing a synopsis like word for word. I've pretty much read it. I did a bit of ad-libbing in between, but word for word,
yeah.
Wrote myself a script for the first time. And it got to the sex scene and I was like halfway through the book and I was like, well, I'm just going to keep reading and write down two words for every three paragraphs.
Yeah,
before that, it was prose and prose and prose.
Yeah, it's starting to become clear now. When it comes to like the gay sex in Chuck Tingle's novels, there is a relatively set path. I'm
gag reflex.
Yeah, like slip past
tight arsehole,
exactly.
Pleasure pain. Yeah,
poking around an arsehole, that sort of thing. Yeah, yeah.
I'm aligning.
Yep. I'm starting to think of it as like the standard Tingle protocol.
The primary Tingle protocol of going through some space thing.
Yes. Okay, cool. So here is my analysis of Space Raptor.
An analysis!
Of Space Raptor Butt Invasion. Space Raptor Butt Invasion is a cute and heartwarming tale about a man who's left completely alone on an alien planet, only to find company and butt-slamming solace from a mysterious extraterrestrial. Isn't that enough? Can't we just leave it at that without picking it apart and becoming yet another accessory in the postmodern pursuit of bringing about the death of the author? Of course not. This Tinker is an interesting one because of its sci-fi setting. This is essentially a first contact scenario. And given that, you might expect Chuck to be making a case for greeting aliens with love. When our hero Lance Tanner comes face to face with the Raptor Orion for the first time, he utters the words, quote unquote, "This can't be real." While this cements the idea that this is an entirely new ground for our human protagonist, no further explanation of the gravity of this event is ever made. So if this isn't about first contact politics, then what? Quote unquote, "Nothing can prepare you for the loneliness of space." Right from the opening passages, Chuck T. Dirk establishes a theme of loneliness with comments like, "It's going to be a long year for you up here," and "Don't think too hard out here, stay light." The dialogue with Pike, the officer departing the station, is largely centered around preparing Lance for the coming isolation. When Pike actually leaves, Lance notes that, "Suddenly, I am completely alone." And when Lance goes to check on the terraformer and sees another spacesuited figure, he ponders, "Was I so upset by the thought of my impending loneliness that I'd created a fellow astronaut in my head?" However you cut it, this is the single theme that receives any real attention within the text. Loneliness is. But we know that Lance isn't left alone. Despite assertions from the station's computer that you will spend the next year alone, there are no records of any new arrivals at this station. We know our hero goes on to meet, greet, and beat the meat of Orion. In fact, by the end of this tale's events, we're left with Lance's assertion that, "I think that the next year up here is going to work out just fine." So if we're not dealing with loneliness, then with what are we dealing? Well, loneliness has a flip side, one expressed well by the philosopher and theologian Johannes Tillich. Loneliness expresses the pain of being alone, and solitude expresses the glory of being alone. We know Chuck Tingle isn't afraid to literally fuck manifested personifications of abstract concepts in his work. So what if Orion isn't real, per se? What if he exists only as a projection of another side of Lance that he can more easily interact with while he comes to terms with his loneliness and learns to embrace solitude? Orion's appearance comes shortly after Pike leaves and Lance is finally confronted with his loneliness. Lance watches Pike's shuttle leave until he can barely see it and then walks off to check on the terraforming station. Given that Lance is making an unassisted walk in an environment that requires the use of a spacesuit, we can assume that this terraforming station isn't too far from home base. It'd be too dangerous otherwise to do alone. When the terraforming station comes into view, there is already, quote unquote, a figure that's clad in a spacesuit standing nearby. I bring this up only because a figure that close to an orbital launch would probably notice it, and yet Orion doesn't remark upon it once. This is a small inconsistency, true, but there are others. There's the computer assertions that there have been no other arrivals in the area. There's the fact that there's no mention of Orion station on the planet whatsoever. The fact Orion explains away his existence with the notion that the ice age that wiped out the dinosaurs was, quote unquote, revisionist history without any explanation as to why. And there's a further implication that follows this, that the dinosaurs have had interstellar technology for at least 80 million years, and yet somehow lacked the ability to detect the presence of a well-established Earth-1 station on Zorbus. Take all of these together, and slowly another picture begins to emerge. One in which Orion is presented only with the barest justification required for Lance for him to feel like the cheek-clapping raptor exists. As an entity, Orion the Raptor represents a more bestial side to Lance's persona. Astronauts have to go through rigorous emotional and psychological training and evaluation before they're sent inescapably hurtling through the void in extremely confining vessels. The sorts of people you want in those situations are those with serious mastery over their emotions, thoughts, and controls. Lives and missions depend on it. But a dinosaur? A lizard-brained creature of impulse and instincts? Well, that represents the perfect counterpoint to this extreme reserve. You can see the disparity in their actions. When Lance saw another mysterious spaceman in an alien world, he was happy simply to ask the computer about it and let it ride. Orion, however, came knocking at his door. When the two of them finally get down to the big sweaty, Lance is submissive and happy to take orders, whereas Orion is the dominant one that decides who gets fucked around here.
Quick interjection.
Yeah, go for it.
A great line in the book, and I'm going to not quote verbatim, but actually just sum it up, is the fact that dinosaurs have been around a lot longer and done a lot more fucking than mankind, so are clearly in charge and know what they're doing. Yeah. I do like that little touch.
It's also relevant that Lance's raptor counterpart is named Orion. There's the obvious astronomical connection of the star constellation of the same name. But in the etiological myths for this heavenly dot-to-dot, Orion is a famed hunter. For a hunter, Orion only ever has one notable hunting companion, Artemis, an ancient Greek goddess and patron to young girls. So we have the bold and powerful masculine energy of Orion as a counterpart to Lance's Artemisian reserved and productive feminine, a yin to a yang. The tale of Lance and... sorry, were you waving for my attention? Yeah, go for it, mate.
No, I was just also going to point out the submissive Dom relationship. It's a passing, very shallow thing, but Orion is very well known for his belt. Bondage implement?
This Orion.
It never approaches bondage.
No, but... it doesn't. But also, the way I decided to read this is, while Orion is known for his belt, this Orion is known for what's just below his belt.
Oh. Do continue.
Also, I don't know if you noticed, but the three fingers also matched up with the three stars of Orion's belt.
Yeah, no, I didn't see that, but that's perfect. Good. Keep going.
So, yeah, what we got? Orion is Orion to Lance's Artemis, a yin to a yang. The tale of Lance and Orion coming together is a story of self-actualization. When Lance first sees Orion, albeit from a distance, Lance tells us, "I freeze in shock and fear," and that they become locked in a bizarre standoff. An understandable reaction to becoming aware of a side of yourself you've trained to keep hidden. Later, when Orion knocks at the door of Lance's home, Lance asks, "Who are you?" Only for Orion to repeat the question back at him, but with an italicized stress on the "who are you." Lance is now being challenged by this other side of his persona to actually consider the true nature of his own identity. Finally, after Lance hears out Orion's flimsy justification for existing, such as I explained three paragraphs ago, there comes a moment from Lance that becomes quite touching when viewed through this new lens. When Orion betrays a faint glimmer of hope at the notion that the two could hang out, Lance simply says, "Sure, you play ping pong?" Oh man, it's fucking beautiful.
Beautiful, given man. Given the fact that just before leaving the station, Lance and Pike were supposed to play low gravity ping pong.
Mm-hmm.
And they are very, very friendly.
Indeed.
So it's that friendship making.
Yeah, it's beautiful, man. Like,
little ground of Yeah, something that's homely, something that's loving and warm and comfy.
So, the other side, like viewed through the dueling personas, the size of persona, this is the moment that Lance finally accepts the full spectrum of his psyche. They go on to play that damn ping pong and get to talking for hours on end and genuinely become, quote unquote, an incredible duo. Eventually, Lance finds a sweetness and gentleness to Orion, despite, quote unquote, despite being a bloodthirsty dinosaur. And he becomes ready to progress.
Carnivore.
Yeah, I left that. I didn't include that in the quote.
Okay.
Bloodthirsty dinosaur carnivore. It was kind of like a tautology at that point, really, wasn't it? Well, I suppose not all dinosaurs were carnivores.
Some were peaceful, some were hunters, some were prey.
Some had big, stampy, smash feet.
But then again, he is a dom. He's definitely going to be the predator of the two.
Of course. So, yeah, this is when Lance...
I'm sorry. Yeah, I've just got an image in my head of a submissive brontosaurus, and it's making me laugh quite a bit.
Oh, my God.
All that neck, all that girth. Fucking dominance.
Could you imagine a brontosaurus in a dildo gimp mask?
Album art. Album art. Heather looks like she's giving up on life behind you, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, she's coming to know. She's colouring
in. Can you draw me a gimp mask Belgian brontosaurus?
I'm just colouring in my colouring book that's called Garden.
Yeah, but you could do the album art for this entire issue if you just do that for me.
No, thank you.
All right, fine.
I can't
leave it to
draw.
Me.
You can Photoshop very well.
Sorry, Taryn, carry on.
No worries. So, eventually, Lance finds a sweetness and gentleness to Orion, despite being a bloodthirsty dinosaur, and he becomes ready to progress from merely accepting these elements of his personality to fully embracing them. It's certainly no mistake that Lance, the person who has to grow, is the one who initiates the dong-throbbing congress with the question, you ever think about what it'd be like to fuck a human? The Raptorous scene that follows is the final act of butt-rotting consummation that brings together Lance's self as a whole. To revisit the words of Johannes Tillich, this is wherein Lance started the story separate from the Orion-shaped manifestation of his repressed personality traits. He has now literally come together with it and embraced the full glory of all that is Lance. He has progressed from loneliness to solitude. It's a final point. Modern queer social philosopher RuPaul has a saying. if you can't love yourself, how in the hell are you going to love somebody else?
Can I get an amen?
So if Chuck Tingle's own refrain of love is real is to be true, then one's love must extend also to oneself by oneself. This is what Tingle means to Exolinus by writing Space Raptor Bite Invasion, a story about the love and glory of solitude.
Beautiful, mate. Well done.
Well done. Yeah,
thank
well done,
much.
Chuck.
Thank
it
you
was
very
beautiful.
Much.
These nuts.
Sorry, I lost my word. Soundboard there a bit.
Prick. all right, okay. Is it Tinkletron time? Where is he?
I thought
I saw him earlier on, but I guess he's.
Can you hear him coming?
I thought I could, but I just.
I am Tinkletron.
There he is.
Greetings, horny human. I am Tinkletron 4000 book review score, but all scores are final.
I turned it off. Okay, cool. So this is the part where we score the Chuck Tingle story that we've just read based on the GameSpot review scores. First of all, we're going to look at the graphics, which is look at the Tingle, the cover up. Next, we're going to go into the story, replace it with the sound. Let's get to the Tingle. It's the pacing. Gameplay, of course, giving you the Tingle. It's the sexiness. Value, saving you some Tingle. It's the value for money. It's a reviewer's tilt at the end to make our Tingle tilt on how we feel about the book in general, to give it either a positive or a negative skew. Have you looked up?
I am now looking at it, and you're right. He is,
it's a velociraptor
on a Segway.
To be fair, no. You know what? I've just noticed something.
What's that?
That's a T-Rex.
Oh, shit.
That is a T-Rex in a spacesuit on a space Segway. That is not a velociraptor.
Is that a T-Rex? It's
not a velociraptor.
It's the square. Let me tell you it's the square jaw, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just not streamlined enough. It's not like clever girls kind of looking face. Face from the NC of Jurassic Park.
It's the face of someone who go round to dinner at a mate's house, eat more than they were really welcome to eat, and then never thank anyone for it. So that's T-Rex all over. Ah, man.
That was going to be a four because they did have a dinosaur in a spacesuit on a Segway, which is clearly a four score. But it's going to be a three.
No.
That's not Tom, a fucking velociraptor.
We've got to give this a zero because it's not a velociraptor. It doesn't accurately depict the book.
No. But it accurately depicts everything else. You've got the sand dune. You've got the astronaut in space. Although, again, wait a minute. Lance isn't in a spacesuit. He'd die.
Yeah.
He's topless.
And so would the dinosaur. There's no dome or a helmet whatsoever.
That is...
This might be a low score.
I'm going to give it... I mean, you could argue to give it one if you really wanted to. But I'm thinking zero.
It evokes the story, but misses out key details, so I'm going to probably say a one.
Let's give it a one.
Damn, son.
Damn.
That is a low score. We've only ever had slammed by my substantial amount of press generated by my books, pounded in by the pound. That was the only other one score we've ever had. Anyway, getting to the tingle, the pacing. Now, I fucking love the pacing of this book.
It is bosh, 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 bosh. Bosh, 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 bosh.
But also, it's not so much just playing by numbers and getting the points across. And like, there's some intrigue there. There's the spaceman that we know nothing about, quickly resolved. Like, literally, he fell asleep on the couch, and then 10 seconds later, there's the spaceman hanging out with him.
Yeah.
His space raptor hanging out with him, shall I say. But there was some intrigue and some building. I'm going to say that's a perfect five.
Yeah, no, I'm willing to go with that for sure. And it was also like, for comparison, like impounded by the pounds. Like I don't think we gave that a five. I think we gave it a three or whatever. But it kind of felt like you had to work to get to the actual fucking, and then
pounded by the pound, we gave a five.
Did we?
Yep.
Oh man, I would revise that now, but all scores are final.
All scores are final.
Yeah.
Sorry, hang on. Tingletron, what do you think? All scores are final. Exactly. So
yeah, okay, yeah, no. Sorry,
I didn't mean to doubt you, Tingletron. Okay, so now we've got sexiness. Now I'm gonna say the sex scene itself, not particularly sexy. It was fine. It was hit and miss. The lead up and the tension. That lead up of, would you fuck a human? No, because human women are too weak to take my pounding. But what about a human man? That tension gave me a bit of a semi, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, that little back and forth was pretty much the only thing going for it. Like the build
it was a good tension.
What was the scale again? Like three, you get a semi, four, full-blown erection, five, you actually had to wank.
Yeah, so I'm going to say probably a three.
I think it's going to be a two. This one did not get me hard.
2.5, we'll call it.
Oh, yes.
And don't give me fucking shit about tempo.
Man, I want to give you so much shit right now. Oh, it's so annoying.
Tingletron, is that how you operate?
Fuck no!
I'm sorry, I tried.
Okay.
Anyway,
cool. And then next.
saving some tingle. It's the value score, value for money. I thoroughly enjoyed my time in this book.
Yeah.
Four.
Three.
Three.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm fine with the three. Three's fine.
I'd go with a three purely because, like some of the other books have kind of made me kind of like when I've been writing the essay, I've actually had to like wander off and just kind of find and do like proper research. And this one, like, I didn't really feel that impulse. I probably could have looked up some more philosophy on the nature of solitude, but it didn't like expand in the way for me that the others have. So three.
Okay. And now we get down to it. We're on the reviewer's tilt, the Tingle tilt, if you will. We are on a very low score so far. We are on a 4.6. We gave this a perfect score of 5. It will take it to a 6.6, which is one of our lower scoring books. I feel this book is greater than the sum of its parts.
Yeah, I don't feel inclined to give it more than a 4.
See, I'd be a 5. Wow. 4.5. It is 4.5. You said it.
You motherfucker.
Which gives it its overall score. It's 4 score. It's Tingle 4 score.
It's Ting total.
It is the second to bottom. The only worst score we've ever had is slammed by my substantial amount of press generated by my book Pounded by the
Which
Pound.
Which is still fucking wild that that's at the bottom of the pile. This is what a cover can do.
Do you question Tingletron? Are you questioning me?
No. It's all right, dude.
Please put down the knife, Tingletron. I will fucking murder you! No, I know, I understand. No, all scores are final. That's right, all scores are final!
Yeah, no, Tingletron is fine. No, you don't need to look quite that looming. No, it's cool. We get it. We'll sit down.
My uncle was a loom! Okay.
All
right, fine.
All right, dude. Okay, yeah, sorry.
I think you're being racist now.
I didn't realise that was a trigger word. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry.
Apparently his uncle was a loom.
He was a loom.
Being racist.
He was a fucking loon.
So there we have it.
I need to go run and grab the pot so we can draw the next one. Tom,
thank you very much for that.
You can vamp for a minute or so.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So going forward, I think that go on, you do your thing. Go. Sorry, I'm watching him on the web stream. Yeah, I think going forward, we are going to do the book report as a separate recording, put out at the same time as the original issue, but we'll do the usual 2-hour recording of the podcast and also have a separate book club that you can go to on YouTube or the RSS episode stream. Anyway, that's starting next issue. And I can see Taron running around like a nutcase. He always looks like a gazelle with hair. Like lots and lots of hair.
What's that?
Really scared gazelle just walking, running across the plains looking for some pot, avoiding all predators in his way, but with a lot of hair. So what have you got?
What was that, Tom?
Basically, I filled everyone in saying that we need to put this out as a separate issue in the podcast stream and on YouTube. Why am I filling you in? You can listen to the fucking podcast for once. Fuck off.
I could.
What have you got?
But I won't. Okay, so the next Chuck Tingle we will be reading is...
Ba, 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 ba.
Oh, wow.
What is it called?
Yes! Oh, this is amazing. This is called Eaten Right by the Mysterious S Symbol Everybody Used to Draw.
It's like boom headshot, boom headshot, boom headshot.
Oh man! Perfect. Oh, I can't even begin to imagine what the actual deeper.
I'm really hoping this is a lesbian story.
I think Ethan Wright. I think it probably suggests it is going to be lesbian. Do you know what? This is one that jumped out at me when I printed off the book, his bibliography and cut them out, despite the fact that you'd already done that. This is one of the titles that jumped out at me that I was kind of hoping we'd get to. So I am excited.
Brilliant. The main reason why I'm excited about it being a lesbian one is this really felt underrepresented so far. And I want the full spectrum of Tingle. Especially going in and playing an RPG for it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, this would be our second.
I need to know the Tingleverse.
This would be our. I mean, if this is a lesbian one, this would be our second lesbian Tingler. I'm also looking forward to eventually getting around to reading a Tingler that doesn't actually include any sex.
Yeah, an asexual, non-sexual, or otherwise sexual.
There's one. The name that jumped out of me was something along
Fucking hell.
There's one in the COVID series, actually.
Yes, there is. And there's another one, like, fedora wearing Raptor is a jerk so it doesn't get sex from me. Or something that's like the gist of the title, which I kind of... I really want to read.
But anyway, we're going to hang on to that energy and the feeling that we need to go to these Tingle Universe books and carry on with our fucking podcast as if it matters fucking jack shit. And here we go.
So, Tom, have you got a topic for us?
No, you're the one with the pot.
Yeah, you were meant to think of one.
You literally said, do another topic. I'll think of one in the meantime. You goddamn, you GD son of a B.
Yeah, I forgot about that because it was before the podcast. Okay, so if you were an ant, if you were an ant,
it's
the size, proportions, and scale of an ant, what would your Everest be?
Wait.
Booby.
Sorry, just for clarification. Are we an actual ant or just the size, shape, and proportions? You've
size, shape, and proportions of an ant.
Size, shape, and proportions of an ant. Yours would be
what
a booby.
What would your Everest be?
Booby.
Who's booby?
A big booby.
Well, there's only one Everest, so you
Kel's
need to...
booby. Kel's got big boobies.
Left or right?
Would you
the
like...
left one's got the
tattoo. Yeah, the left one with the tattoo.
So Heather's answer there is Kel's left tit.
Pre or post giving birth to a child?
Oh, her tits are massive right now.
Yeah, they're huge.
They've got some goddamn column. Do you know what? Kel sent me a picture the other day of
I'm sure she's going to love the fact we're talking about her fucking tits on there.
Of course she is. She loves tit attention.
She doesn't give a shit.
She sent me a picture the other day of Oz, like little Ozzy, having a feed on the left tatted tit, and he's just inadvertently throwing horns.
Fucking right, living up to his namesake.
It's amazing. Okay, so what would my Everest be if I was the size?
Also, can I just take it back a bit?
Yeah, go for it.
So what we've basically got there is Brian Blessed at the summit of Kel's boob, screaming about his eagle men, hawk men.
Just
hawk men fly.
Could you imagine? Sorry, you just the idea of a teeny tiny Brian Blessed standing proud atop abreast Kel's left nipple, going, "I need to get down now. I've got pulmonary edema." okay, so if I was the size and proportions of an ant, my Everest would be a brontosaurus wearing a dildo gimp mask.
Very well played. To be fair, that's my Everest now, so I need to overcome that and make a Photoshop.
I mean, this is the thing though. Everest is real. Dildo brontosaurus is wearing dildo gimp masks exists only in our dreams.
If we think about this, why do people climb mountains? Because they're there and because it is something to overcome, right? And the reward, the reward is also part of that. The ultimate reward of knowing you've conquered and you can say you've done it. Ants, their one big thing is seeking out glucose more than anything else, glucose and building materials. So it will be climbing to the top stack of the cane sugar factory. Tate and Lyle. They'll climb to the top of Tate and Lyle and plant their flag well and truly in the smokestack.
The factory or the HQ registered in the Cayman Isles? I'm assuming.
Where's the sugar at? Cayman Isles. Cayman Isles. It is.
Have you, Dom, at some point in your little rant there, you need to, or not rant, sort of explanation. Have you ever seen the video of William Shatner talking about mountaineers and mountaineering in general?
I don't believe so, no.
Oh my God, it's amazing. It basically makes a case for the fact that, like, when people go mountain climbing, they're essentially having sex with a mountain. it's really fucking wild. Like, following his, you can kind of see where he's coming from. ish, I guess. Like, if you're if you were wearing like those kind of 5-pound X-ray glasses you used to order off of, you used to be able to order out of magazines. If you were wearing one of those and looking at his point, you could kind of see where he was coming from, I guess. But it was just, it's, man, honestly, do yourself a favor, look up William Shatner mountaineering, and it's just, mwah.
Will do. Maybe insert a little clip here, or maybe cut it out, depending on how you feel, editing Tom in the future.
Fuck off, you prick. Fucking drunk wanker.
Anyway, all right, Dom, are you there?
Yes, I am here.
Hey, he's back from
there
the
pizza. There we go.
Cool.
So what's your Ant Everest going to be?
Ant Everest?
So if you were the size, proportion, and scale of an ant, what would your Everest be? Take your time. I will edit out the size.
Do you know what? Oh, go for it, Dom.
What about just... No, that's stupid. Normal Everest. It's like... Well, an answer Everest could be Everest.
Hang on.
Pretty fucking dedicated, Dan.
I mean, that's Everest times, like... That's got several orders of magnitude behind it.
Okay, it's time... it's time for the
percolator. Is it time for the percolator? Is it time for the percolator?
So... It's time for the percolator. It's time for the
percolator. I'm just going to do like a quick... I've got an iPad here, so I'm just going to do a quick search for how many times bigger...
How many times bigger is Everest than an ant?
Is a human to an ant? Let's see if this comes up with anything. How many times must you multiply an ant's mass to equal that of a human's? The answer is 14 million. Okay, cool. So.
Everest is now 14 million times its height. So how high is that?
How tall is Everest? Is, 8,848. So,
Taryn, I'm getting flashbacks to our sound engineering problem from earlier. My brain is melting.
Oh, no. It's all right. I've got this. Okay. Okay. So, 8,848. 8,848 divided by... 14 million
is
0.000632 meters. So, well, I mean, that's...
I think you've done the math wrong.
What? 8,000.
The height of Everest. What are we trying to solve?
So Everest is 8,848 meters high.
Mm-hmm.
So that's us to us. So the ant equivalent would be 14 million times smaller than that.
Oh, okay. All right. So what height have we got actually in centimeters? At
least? So
like divided by 100.
So above that, but so 0.6 centimeters. No, that can't be right.
No, there's no way that's right. A fucking ant is 0.6 centimeters. Yeah. Good math. Well done.
I'm pretty sure the math is sound.
No. So now I'm understanding right, the soundboard issue.
Okay. So the other answer I had was like my other Everest would be Liam Neeson's precipitous dong.
Oh. How ponderous? Big is it?
Unfortunately, I don't have any to go. Ready to go. But how big is it? If
I'm in lockdown. I'm in a lockdown. Editing's fine. Let's go look up some Liam Neeson jokes.
We've got to that point. Yeah, wicked. Let's do it.
Yeah, no, fuck it.
Leesoncock.com.
Leesoncock.com.
Neeson.com.
Is that at, is that actually it?
Yes.
Was that set up by Ralph Garman and Kevin Smith, or is that just something that has happened independently? Do we know?
I'm going through the Tumblr, so I'm going liamneesonscock.tumblr.com. Liam Neeson's cock is so big it's getting its own digital streaming platform.
Okay. Liam Neeson's cock is so big it's the only argument for why we're not living in a simulation.
Think of the polygons.
Just the amount of data required for that. You can't just ad hoc stream that. That needs to be pre-rendered.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big that for insurance purposes, his sexual partners have to wear a parachute if they want to get on top. Oh, I love it. That's the Everest right there.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big that Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers once tried to do a backflip with it. Liam Neeson's cock is so big that if an ant walks up to it, or an ant-sized human walks up to it, they'd probably just look at it and just go, nah, I'm all right, mate.
Liam Neeson's cock so big he doesn't clock Bucky, clock walls.
Beg your fuck?
Liam Neeson's cock is so big he doesn't cock block, he cock
moves. Ah, nice, I like it. all right, I'm done with this. Captain Sickbeard, Dom, you're right, Dom. Yes. Captain Sickbeard, how are you, Sheb? How are you, friend? Do you have, perchance, a topic that you would like to forward?
Make one up. I just had to do the
I. I.
Thing.
So, right, Dom's topic is I. So...
No,
Tom.
No. What would you be doing right now if the pandemic wasn't happening?
Exactly this, probably.
Working, unfortunately.
Yeah, no, it's quarter past
it's 10. It's Saturday night.
It's quarter past 10 on a Saturday. I might just about be leaving the theatre right now.
I will be at work finishing my fourth pint.
Jesus. Heather, would you be colouring in?
Maybe, sitting on the sofa or colouring in, waiting for you to get home.
Please don't tell me that's what you do. You just kind of sit there and just play.
It's not. She has a full and fruitful life
alone
without you. In fact, it'd be a lot more fruitful without you.
There is. Oh!
I mean, yeah, well, I don't know, because we would have gone out for Thursday night for Paula's birthday, so I probably wouldn't have been
That's
out
true.
If there was no pandemic.
I'll get you later.
We'll probably all be hungover because we've missed so many people's birthdays.
Oh, man. There's a theory that, there's a very real possibility. So Saturdays is also the day I tend to play D&D with your group, Tom. So there is a chance. Call it like maybe, how regular do you play? Maybe like one in 16 chance that we might have been playing D&D today. There is that. Yeah. And let's face it, if it's your group, we'll still be going at this point.
Yeah. We do play for like 10 hours at a time by the feel of it. Sorry, going back to the whole birthday thing on lockdown.
Yeah.
Like, end of the month is my birthday. Does everyone want a social distancing thing in my car park? We can all just pull up, like, drive-through birthday.
Ooh.
No, because we're still in lockdown.
No, you don't get out the car. You don't get out of the car. There's no physical contact. You don't roll down your windows. I will provide you with drinks. There'll be cake. I'll make sure there's a cake.
But you can't touch the cake because you can't touch anything you've touched.
I'll throw it in your windscreen. Fuck off.
It's all right. We'll just have some soapy water around and we can just kind of wash it down. Yeah, no, Tom, I really like that idea, especially because I can't drive. So Heather will be the one doing the driving.
And you'll be doing the drinking.
Yes. This is, this I feel is the both of us playing to our strengths.
I would not say driving is a strength. And that does not sound fun for me to just drive around while you're really drunk in my car.
Comparables.
But it's by Chessington, Heather.
Yeah, well, I can't go there because it's closed because there's a fucking pandemic
going on.
You can drive
past and listen to the animals, Heather.
No, because we're still in a lockdown.
No, fine.
It's all right, Tom. You can just come pick me up. I'll sit in the back.
No. No. Social distancing. You're in the boot.
Do you know what? I've never seen it before. The waveform of my laugh looks like a very attractive spruce tree.
Okay, go back a couple episodes on Regular Features podcast.
Yeah. Matt Lee's trying to make a dick with his sound wave.
Makes a perfect dick with his fucking voice on the waveform.
Wait. Because it really sounds like wee!
Wee!
Oh, that is a bad dick.
Hang on. Well, it's based on volume, isn't it?
That's Man, that's a fucking fox dick if I've ever
start
seen
with one. The balls. It's easier if you start with the balls.
Okay, so you created actually like a reasonably stable incline with your attempt there, Dom.
Are we taking in turns?
Yeah. Why the fuck
are
not?
Are we literally steering their fucking feature now, aren't we?
Yes.
Whoa!
You held on too long. Like the first part kind of looked like a remora fish, and then there was a long, not much, and then just like an island of noise. So
what you're saying is pencil dick.
You saying pencil dick was closer in shape to what you just attempted to do.
Pencil dick. Cool. Anyway, this is bad listening. Let's get
yes, it is. All right, cool. What was it?
Dom didn't say what he would be doing.
Dom, what would you be doing if we weren't in lockdown?
I would have probably just finished a show in opera. I'd be sat outside my pod with a fire going, drinking.
I forgot about your pod. Yeah, I forgot about your pod.
The bunker bins that we rent for the opera. Living in my little pod.
Ah, oh, that's cool. What else would I feasibly be doing? I mean, I could say wanking, but that's not going to be affected by the lockdown whatsoever.
No. That's routine at this point.
All right, okay.
On the hour, every hour.
Ow! Ow!
8 p.m. every Thursday. We go outside our houses and wank for the NHS.
Sailors set their clocks to it every day.
1, 2, 3. If you type that into your phone, you'll hear us all wanking.
Yeah.
Anyway, Taz, next topic.
Okay. One last topic before we close out. And do you know what? I'm not going to pick one from the pot. I'm going to. I had a thought today. And I think there's a topic to be spun from it. Invent a machine to accomplish one small, inconsequential, almost useless task. For me, I was thinking about like how I invent a machine that I could just put a scrunched up sock into it and it would figure out if there's a hole in it, rather than me having to stick my hat, like unfold it, stick my hand in, and then find if there's a, or even worse, get it on my foot and then find the hole. So it might be like a sock hole finding machine.
I like it.
An auto darner.
Auto darner, or an auto anti darner, to be fair, because it's avoiding the darner effect.
I mean, I'm not looking to fix the holes. I'm just...
Yeah, exactly. So it's the auto anti-darner. It can identify when darning is needed and let you know.
Auto darn analysis. Adam!
Analysis.
I just call it Adam. Auto darn analysis machine.
Perfect. My robot is going to be one that perfectly either crushes or chops garlic to the point where I'm satisfied and there's no mess. Because every single version of getting garlic into a recipe involves mess or some nitty gritty annoying thing. So the best one I ever found, at the moment, my current solution is a rocker. So it's basically like a U-shaped bit of metal.
Mm.
And in the bottom of the U, there are holes and you just rock it back and forth with left and right hands on the top of the U.
Right.
And then the garlic will crush through. And that works quite well, but it's not ideal. The bits of garlic are still large. Cutting it by knife, that's just a laborsome, annoying thing, but it is the best way of dealing with garlic in your recipe. A grater or a crusher will leave mess that you have to deal with and you have to scrape off.
I don't know, man. That little, like, self-contained garlic grater that we had when we lived together, the yellow thing with like, the plastic.
My micro grater.
That is the single best garlic solution I've ever encountered. At the moment,
it's not ideal.
Why is it not ideal? I don't understand. It's easy to use. It's easy to clean. Are you annoyed that you're still going to take all of the skin off of the garlic cloves?
The thing with the micro garlic grater thing was the fact that you had to clean it thoroughly. Otherwise, it would taint everything else you use for it. If you use it as, maybe you need a sole micro grater.
Wait, what the fuck else would you use that for? It's such
parmesan.
A fine grater.
Parmesan is a perfect parmesan grater.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But then again, you're also using garlic and parmesan. It tastes like garlic.
Man, that doesn't sound like a bad deal.
I've solved your problem. You need an air cannon and a fine mesh strainer.
Oh, you mean like McDonald's fries, how they're cooked and they're made?
Yes.
That would work, but that would take up an entire room of my house.
Yeah, but what a room.
Gotta do it for the garlic.
Gotta do it for the garlic.
Gotta do it for the garlic. There's a title for the episode.
Gotta do it for the garlic. Hey, mister, how's it going? I'll suck your dick for some garlic. I'll do it for the garlic. Dom, invent a machine to perform a small, inconsequential, borderline useless task.
I mean, the one I thought of has already been invented, and it's just opening my curtains when the alarm goes off.
The alarm.
Yeah, you're talking about automated, like, curtains, aren't you?
Yeah. I've been sitting here contemplating installing Tripoli in my house just so I can do it.
I'm sure there's like a less like heavy duty answer to it. I'm sure there must be.
No? Heavy duty means
triple E
well
all
duty.
The way. Borderline box section. Yeah. No, that, yeah. Do you know what? So the solution that I came up with, because I, like, one of the things I found is where we sleep with the curtains closed. Ooh. And Heather doesn't get up and go to work and open the curtains on her way out. Meant I just kind of sleeping in. So what we've ended up doing is, like, we close one curtain and over the other half of the window, we put a hippie sheet. So, it's just thin enough to let light into the room, but it's not like glaring. So if you want to sleep in, you can, but it also provides enough light to wake you up. And that's kind of been filtered light. It's also colorful as fuck, this hippie sheet as well. And it's so much fun for that reason. So that's kind of like our workaround at the moment. But automated curtains, it's like one of the few arguments for like an automated, like an Internet of Things, like an automated house sort of thing.
I thought of another one, an actual one. Mm-hmm. That
you
mentioned. It's basically a letterbox that can discern junk mail from actual mail.
I was just about to say boom, but you've just done it for me, Tom. Well done.
Oh no, it compresses the junk mail into a projectile, so when the next junk mail delivery leaflet person comes to drop junk mail in, there is now ammunition that you...
Would you say it's like... No, wrong one.
It's like, boom, headshot! Boom, headshot! Boom, headshot!
I love the fact that clip is really cut short.
I mean, I got like, the idea, Dom, that, maybe you've kind of got a letterbox that is like, you know, two rollers, and like you put a letter up and the rollers will just suck the letter in and it'll do that quick bit of analysis. And then if it is junk mail, it will just fire it right back out.
I reckon we could write the code for that, Dom. But that's not hard.
Yeah, I mean,
that's
it's
technology.
It's
not that difficult.
But you've also got to write like algorithms for identifying junk mail, like based on visual data. That's really complex.
Yeah, but do you know what the big visual data is there? If it has a returning address,
menu.
So if you had a something on the back of the envelope that had a returning address, it's not going to be junk mail.
But
if it's got your name on it.
Bank statement.
It's got your name on it. It's printed.
Oh, yeah. If it doesn't have your name on it, that's a reasonable.
Or has the names of the last two people that bloody lived in this house, which we still get post for.
Exactly. So you basically make a rule where you have the people that are currently living there. And if it says to the occupier, it immediately gets put in the junk mail thing. Like, this is easy code.
Yeah.
Anyway, Taz has kind of like walked away from the microphone and
he's just making a
host
drink
tonight because he sucks.
He does suck. He's making a drink.
I'm back in.
All right. So
I've not gone far.
To be fair, 30 second break while I pee too. So.
Okay.
Heather.
Yeah.
Can you ask Taryn how long we got left?
I don't think Taz put it back on again. The timer.
No, it's
what does it say?
He didn't put the timer back on.
So we're probably pretty much at the end stages, yeah?
No,
we're pretty much at the end times, yeah?
No, we are. That's why I said one last topic. Oh wait, we didn't have an answer. Heather, can you invent a machine to do like a small borderline inconsequential task?
The only thing I thought of is threading my needle for me. Especially if I get older. It's going to get harder.
I mean, a needle threading machine would...
I mean, they do...
That would probably make a lot of money.
Well, no, because it'd probably be more effort than actually just fucking threading the needle yourself. You do have... There is these little thingies that make a little metal thing that's meant to thread needles, but you need to have, like, a big hole in the needle to use that thing.
Whereas
I use, like, really teeny... Like a beading needle. Beading needles are the worst to have to thread, and especially because at work we have to use cotton thread, and the cotton thread, like, unravels. It's really annoying to put through my needle. Can take some a couple of attempts sometimes.
There's money in that there idea. and Tom's run away.
Tom's
so,
to the toilet for a second.
Yeah, fair enough. Hey, Dom.
Yes.
We didn't. You weren't here at the start of the show. What have you been up to?
Just being at home. Today. What time is it? Yeah, today I went down the allotment. I was going to just do some tidying, and then. The allotment warden then said I could have a shed off one of the unclaimed allotments.
Oh, nice.
I then spent the whole day dismantling and then rebuilding a shed.
Oh man, that sounds like pick and shit territory right there.
Yeah, it was it was literally carrying it the length of the allotments.
And what you've been playing recently?
Robocraft. I've got back into that. That's fun.
Nice.
I don't know Robocraft. I'll have a look. Have you we mentioned it earlier on. Have you played Opus Magnum?
No.
I think you would fucking love Opus Magnum.
What's that?
It's a hex-based essentially you are an alchemist.
Let's not get into this at the end of the episode.
All right, we'll talk about this. Let's do the sign off and then we'll have a quick chat about it.
Okay.
One last attempt for the penis. Ooh. No.
Oh. Oh. It's so a very short penis.
I don't know the name of it, anyway. but your sound wave, your attempt to make a penis with a sound wave, looks like a very specific Star Wars ship. I can't think of its name. Anyway, let's get rid of this. Let's go.
So, has anyone got anything to plug? I do. Shall I go first?
Yes.
So, given my geeky week, I've also been thoroughly enjoying Digitiser channel on YouTube. Does anyone else know Digitiser? I think, Dom, you might know.
I think so.
Yeah, so Digitiser is Mr. Biffo. And if you're a nerd, retro gamer, or someone who understands like old technology, Mr. Biffo rings a bell. So this is the man. Do you remember Bamboozled on Teletext?
Oh, vaguely. Yeah, very vaguely.
Yeah, that was him.
Oh,
so
okay.
Mr. Biffo, and do you remember on Teletext Digitiser that used to be the game reviews on Teletext?
No, I don't think I ever found it or read it.
Okay, fair enough. So this man and his cohorts basically ran that part of Teletext that no one gave a shit about anymore. I've just seen Rickard jump into the chat.
Rickard's jumped in for the...
Oh shit! There's a video camera.
You got
with
a video
Rickard
as well. How's it going, dude? Sorry, we're just doing the sign off, and you appear to be walking home or something. He's got a fucking fire! Jesus, my god!
Anyway,
I would love a fire.
We're the only
people
seeing this.
Okay, carry on.
So yeah, Mr. Biffo, every drawing you ever saw on Teletext, every like weird satirical humor or abstract humor, whimsical humor you ever saw on Teletext was him. And he became, with Digitiser being the big gaming thing it was in Britain at the time.
Yeah.
This is proto-internet, so it was the only gaming news that was to the minute. Or at least to the day,
shall we say.
He was the sole heir for it. So, yeah, he now has a YouTube channel where he just does random shit. Usually retro gaming aspired, but either way, it's very entertaining. So Digitiser on YouTube. Go look it up and enjoy.
Cool.
Anyway.
Heather, would you like to plug anything?
RuPaul getting me through every week and also helping me remember.
Yes, Queen!
Saturday is the day it comes out. That's the day it is today. Bye!
Yes, American social philosopher RuPaul.
Well done.
Dom, you got anything to plug?
No.
He's not there. Yo, Rickard, have you got anything to plug?
Oh, we cannot hear Rickard.
Cannot hear Rickard.
We can see him talking.
I don't think he's actually got an audio output channel.
Oh, yeah. It's...
Yeah. Hello, Rickard.
I got to press the button at the same time.
Cool. Yeah, Rickard, you got anything to plug?
I want to plug, just give one back to the nice words by Cass. And I want to plug his book, Walking Out. I really like it.
Aww.
You're sweetie.
It's good, isn't it?
Same back to you.
Cheers, dude. Oh yeah, actually, do you know what? In response, I've just muted Rickard, because the echo was murdering me. But in response, I will replug the Corrupted Lullaby. Last weekend. Saturday, I decided to have a bath, and I was going to have a chat while in the bath, but then the person wasn't around. So I ended up putting on Corrupted Lullaby just to listen by myself in the bath.
By whom?
By Seventh Dimension, the basis of which is OG, original Endurer, our very own Rickards. And do you know what? Usually, I've only ever listened to that album when I like go from one place to another. I'm usually moving. It's the first time I've stayed in one place.
Ketamine to acid,
listening.
You know.
Yeah, sure. Nicotine to nicotine, you mean?
He's saying something else.
Hang on. I've got him right muted.
How was the water after 2 hours?
Oh, okay. So it only lasted an hour and 20, and then I did the other 40 minutes drying off.
Oh, God.
I took my time with that bath, and it was lovely. But yeah, no, it was just, yeah, I'm like listening to an album when not in a rush completely changes the way you listen to it. It's lovely. So that's going to be my pick.
I'm making wanking symbols.
And also other plug, JJ Whiteley, artisanal vodka.
Awesome.
It's very nice. Now,
who else left a plug? Put in?
I said Rupal.
Yeah, no, I think Rupal. I think we're good to go.
We're all done.
Don would...
Cue the music.
Yeah. Don would naturally plug his... you're back.
Yeah, no, don't know what happened. I think I muted myself.
Fair enough.
Nick Dante, Instagram.
Cool.
Yeah. Link's in the show notes. He's fucking awesome. Anyway. Cue the music. Share and tell a friend. So we're going to get more listeners. Our website is podtopicpodcast.com. Go there to submit a topic. Go to submit a topic tab. I'm not going to do that again. And submit a topic. Rate and review us on iTunes, Stitcher, all your fucking platforms. I don't care where the fuck you listen to it. Review us. Fuck off. As of next episode, we're not going to do the fucking book club in the actual issue. We're going to do it as a separate thing because no one likes it apart from me and Taryn. We'll see how far this goes and maybe do some YouTube videos.
Yeah, boy.
Anyway, what you got to talk about? Did I hear a ranger fruit coming over the horizon, or is that possibly Tingle Tron going
on? No, I'm not a ranger fruit.
Anyway,
I would like to forward a very big and heartfelt thank you very much to Oranga Fruit with two U's and Umlauts.
Umlaut!
For the use of their song Triples with three P's.
Pop, 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 pop!
You motherfucker! Triples with three P's.
Pop, 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 pop!
Could be found on the self-titled album Oranga Fruit with two U's and Umlaut.
Hello!
And... while they are...
What's up with your brain? Come on.
So you made a noise. It sounded like you'd encountered an error or something. You just went, oh, no. but yeah, okay.
A-Town.
So, Oranga Fruit are no longer, two years ago now, are no longer extant. But you can, thank you very much. You can, however, find tracks by Monkey Fist and Scotch Lobster, just released an EP. You can find all of that shit via Wobbly Records or just search for them on Bandcamp and SoundCloud and that shit. Go buy some shit. They deserve your money. It's good music.
And with that, can I have a frosty mountain? Imagine, if you will, a mountain landscape covered in snow. You have snowboarders, we have skiers just making their way along the road. Can we have a ski hill?
Would you kindly pee in my mouth, please?
Oh, great. Please tell me you're recording that, because now I have two different samples.
Oh, yeah, you do. Wait. Do you want me to do another read on it?
Give different readings, emphasizing different words.
Give me different emotions to go for.
Can I have scared?
Would you kindly pee in my mouth, please?
Now I want Gary Oldman being scared.
Jesus Christ. My brain feels exactly like it did when we were fucking around with patches in the two mixers earlier.
Just Just melt.
It's just like, this bit goes here and that there. But what does any of it mean?
It's all right. I'll save you.
Peace up. Peace A-Town.
Yeah. Reset. Let's get on with the podcast.
Yeah, let's do it. All right, cool.
Done. Finally, this fucking podcast is over.
Jesus. It's almost like we're doing it to torture ourselves at this point, Tom. Really. We're getting to a point now where it's just like, are we still, having fun? Are we still having fun, though? Are we even still having fun?
It's the point where we have to make an appointment at 4 a.m. to try and sort out the fucking soundboard and mixers and everything else.
You're right. Let's do that. Let's do that bit again. I think that's probably the most fun I've had all day.
Fuck off. I ain't doing that right
now. Actually, that is not the most fun I've had all day. Yes, you're right. Absolutely, right. Baby. We did have sex earlier on, and that was very fun. Also, we did watch Mousetrap.
Mousetrap was really good.
we did watch Mousetrap earlier with Nathan Lane and Lee Evans. And fuck me, dude. Oh, I can't believe I forgot to bring it up in the podcast. That film fucking slaps. It's still so fucking good. Like,
It's no Birdcage. If you want, what's his name?
Nathan Lane? Lee Evans. Or Lee Evans.
Yeah. That's Birdcage.
I've not even heard of it before.
It's with Robin Williams.
Lee Evans and Robin Williams?
No, the other two.
Oh, Nathan Lane and... So. Yeah.
Can we just shut the fuck up? What the fuck, Richard, are you doing?
Burning
stuff.
This is a Burning, Swede.
Of course.
It is natural environment. This can only, I assume, be either pagan or satanic in nature.
Swedish tradition, you know?
Yeah, like I
Swedish
said,
torch.
Pagan or satanic. Oh god, that is such a fucking nice brazier. Can you get a little closer on that, Rickard? Like get a little
I would like my skin intact, but sure.
Oh man, cool. That is a fucking sexy little brazier. I love that.